President Trump has been continuing to downplay concerns of the coronavirus even after he was hospitalized with his own case. Here's what he had to say about it at a rally in Pennsylvania last night.
I got to get out and I have to meet people and I have to see people. And I know it's risky to do that, but you have to do what you have to do. You know, I'm the president. I can't sit in the basement and say, let's wait this thing out. I'm not going to do that. And now I'm immune, they tell me. I'm immune. I could come down and start kissing everybody.
A recent article in The Atlantic entitled What Strength Really Means When You're Sick explains how some of these metaphors President Trump and others are using when talking about COVID-19 are actually making the pandemic worse. For more on this, I want to bring in Ed Yong. He's a staff writer at The Atlantic covering science. He is the author of that article. Hi, Ed. Welcome. Thank you for joining us. So can you explain what you mean by these strength terms for coronavirus or other sicknesses and why they can actually be harmful?
Yeah, so these are very commonly used metaphors. People talk about being a fighter, beating a disease because you're strong. All this rhetoric of strength, warfare, fighting is very common, but is also very problematic because the flip side of equating strength with health is to say that if you are sick or if you die, that you are weak, that you have lost a battle. A lot of people who work in healthcare avoid using this language for exactly this reason, and it just doesn't have any merit to it. Sure, your physical state or, you know, your mental health can affect the course of your illness, but that's not to say that people who, you know, do badly with an illness have some sort of, have physical weakness or have a lack of mental strength. Far, far from it. We've seen throughout this pandemic that even young, healthy, fit people have been really badly hit by this disease.
And Ed, how has President Trump specifically been using this rhetoric to talk about his own case of coronavirus?
So from his mouth, I think this language is especially pernicious. When he talks about strength, I think he's really talking about two separate things. One is the performance of strength, this very specific, masculinized, quite toxic idea of strength as being about bluster and aggression and volume. It's almost like he's trying to, you know, out-macho the virus, which just doesn't make any sense. And really, also, when he talks about strength, it's more of a reflection of his own massive privilege. When he got sick, he was airlifted to hospital. He received the best possible medical care. He received three treatments, one experimental, a combination that almost no one else, probably no one else, has received. So he has so many advantages going in, and to build his recovery as a matter of strength and fighting and dominance really does a massive disservice to the 210,000 other Americans who have died on his watch and as a direct result of many of his actions this year.
No doubt that words really do matter. And Ed, you also researched the history of this language. Tell us what you found and how it led us to where we are now.
So there is a long history of conflating physical strength with other kinds of strength, including moral strength. There was a whole movement called muscular Christianity that began in the 19th century that tied these things together, that suggested that if you are physically strong, if you do a lot of exercise, you are also morally strong. And that movement influenced things like the creation of the YMCA. It influenced Teddy Roosevelt and his sort of cowboy persona. And that idea, that conflation between physical and moral strength also ties into misogyny. It was specifically a reaction to what was perceived as a feminization of modern society. It ties into things like imperialism, eugenics, this idea of white supremacy. All of these things, plus a huge amount of ableism, feed into this conflation of language, this use of strength rhetoric to talk about our battle with disease. And we can't divorce these metaphors from each other. We need to be wary about what we're really talking about when we start using language of strength and fighting and all the problematic areas, forms of discrimination that are tied into that.
That is just a fascinating history. And so did any of the health officials or anyone you spoke with when researching this piece give any suggestions as to better terms to use when someone is sick?
Yeah, it's difficult, right? Because this type of language is so ingrained in the way we talk about language. Often people, the second most common brand of metaphor that people use involves a journey, something that gives people agency but doesn't portray their experience of illness as a fight. And I think, you know, we should be thinking about language that invokes empathy, a sense of collaboration and cooperation. That has proven to be so important this year as we think about COVID-19. Our actions affect each other, and the only way we are going to get out of this is together. Think about the etymology of the word pandemic itself, pan and demos, all people. Mm. That's what we need to get out of this and to you know, create a better, fairer, more equitable future.
So, Ed, instead of saying you're fighting the disease or you're on the road to recovery, can you just simply say you're getting better?
Well, I would hope that we can say that. You know, I would point out that a lot of people have been struggling with COVID symptoms for a very long time, for months on end. A lot of those people aren't even getting recognized as for their illness, let alone receiving treatments. You know, I think we should be trying to extend compassion and empathy towards everyone who has this illness, and recognize the huge amounts of privilege that some people have, the disadvantages that others have, and, you know, try and pull together.
All right. Well, Ed Yong, thank you so much. Really fascinating stuff.
Thanks for having me.